Now, Globe vows to defend its position as the number one telco in the Philippines, even as it lost about 30 million subscribers. Jackie Pascual now joins us on the line for more on that story. Hi, Jackie.
Hi, good afternoon, Stanley. Telecommunications company Globe has vowed to defend its position as the number one telco in terms of the number of mobile subscribers. At a virtual media briefing, Globe President and CEO Ernest Cu said the company has been the leader in mobile for the past many years and they will try to defend that position. He was reacting to a statement made by rival PLDT President and CEO Al Panillo, who said that Smart will narrow down the lead and the gap with Globe and eventually reclaim the top spot from Globe. Based on data from the Department of Information and Communications Technology, after the SIM registration period, there are now 53.7 million registered Globe SIMs, 52.5 million for Smart, and 7.7 million for D2. Ernest Cu said that Globe is more focused on revenue market share leadership rather than the number of subscribers. Last December, DICT reported that Globe has 86.7 million SIMs. That's a reduction of over 30 million SIMs compared to today. But Globe explained that majority of unregistered SIMs are not active SIMs and has no impact to the revenues of the telco. And here's what Ernest Cu has to say.
We never expected to register 80 million SIMs. At the 54 million mark, our revenues were not affected. Captured leadership in 2016. It's now 7 years, and we expect to defend that as well in the coming years.
Stanley, Smart, meanwhile, said that it is happy that it has narrowed the gap from Globe from about 20 million subscribers last year to just 1.2 million this year after the SIM registration period. Smart also noted that it now has 46.1% market share now compared to last year's 39.5% market share. And that's the latest. Stanley, back to you.
Thanks, Jackie. The Philippine Presidential Palace held a briefing earlier today with Social Welfare Chief Rex Gachalian and Labor Secretary Bienvenido Laguesma, our colleague. Pia Gutierrez now on the line for details on this story. Hi, Pia, what can you tell us?
Yes, Stanley, the Department of Labor and Employment says it is implementing measures to improve its budget utilization and fast-track the delivery of social services for 2023. This after President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. cited the agency's low budget utilization rate for the first quarter of 2023 during a sectoral meeting Tuesday in Malacanang to address issues of underspending in government agencies. Labor Secretary Bienvenido Laguesma, in a press briefing, explains that the low spending of DOLE for the first 3 months of the year was because of the need for the agency to conduct a strict and careful profiling of the intended beneficiaries of their various social protection programs, like the TUPAD or their Cash for Work program. Laguesma says that part of their catch-up plan for the rest of the year involves collaboration with local government units, legislators, and the private sector to identify more projects and hasten their spending. Also cited for its low spending for the first 3 months of the year was the DSWD, and Secretary Rex Gachalian attributed their low spending due to delays in disbursing their funds because of the need to reassess some of the beneficiaries of their flagship 4Ps program, the list of which had not been updated since the COVID pandemic. He explains that at least 700,000 families that have already graduated or delisted from the 4Ps program because of their improved socioeconomic conditions are currently requesting a reassessment from the DSWD for a possible re-inclusion for the 4Ps program, as they noted that COVID restrictions have affected them economically. The DSWD is also reassessing another 700,000 families which have not been assessed due to lockdowns during the COVID pandemic. And Gachalian says they target to finish their assessment of the 1.4 million families by the end of September, after which the agency is prepare to immediately start the distribution of financial aid. The DSWD also says that in complying with the president's directive towards efficient government spending, there's still a need to ensure that those who are really in need will be able to receive government aid. Stanley?
All right. Thank you so much, Pia Gutierrez. The Marcos administration setting aside a boatload of cash to fund infrastructure projects in Luzon. Finance Chief Benjamin Diokno said government will spend at least 6.1 trillion pesos for the island's infra development in a bid to boost economic growth in the region. Now, some 132 out of the Marcos administration's 194 high-impact priority projects will be located in Luzon. Some of these include the EDSA Greenways, the Laguna Lakeshore Road Network Project, the Tarlac-Pangasinan-La Union Expressway or TPLEX Extension Project, and the Ilocos Norte-Ilocos Sur-Abra Irrigation Projects. Now, Dito Telecommunity not worried about calls to ban Chinese companies in the Philippines. Several lawmakers want a ban on Chinese companies and products following China's latest act of aggression on Philippine waters. Earlier this month, a Chinese Coast Guard vessel used a water cannon on a Philippine Coast Guard ship on a resupply mission. Dito, which is partly owned by China Telecom, asserts it is a Filipino company.
We've faced this issue many times. I'm sure we can have, hopefully, an opportunity to talk to our good senators and explain to them why Dito is a Filipino company, why these concerns about, for example, spying or other things were already addressed when our franchise was approved. So we're happy to explain and reassure our stakeholders.
Metro Pacific Investments says two of its subsidiaries are preparing to go public over the next 2 years. West Zone Water Concessionaire Maynila and Metro Pacific Toll Roads. Both units, however, admit they haven't finalized valuations yet.
The franchise calls for a minimum of 30% of our shares being offered to the public. As to the size, it's still being, we're having a lot of financial advisors looking at it today, and there is no indication yet of what the valuation will be. So we don't have any idea yet, but definitely it's going to be in the ballpark of where the water industry is today.
IPO, we hope we will be ahead of Maynilad.
2024.
Possibly, depending on how fast we get our projects done and completed. As you know, what's our current struggle is completing existing projects, okay? Because of right of way. And so I will continue to push right of way issues. The second is getting the committed tariffs that have been approved and ready for implementation. Okay. Now, in terms of new projects, I guess you know that we're signing a new project. That's the joint project with San Miguel.
The Manny Pangilinan-led infrastructure conglomerate last week got shareholder approval to voluntarily delist from the Philippine Stock Exchange by October. It is making a tender offer for shares at an improved price of 520 each. Inflation being felt by Filipinos will still be felt in the coming months. That's according to BMI Country Risk and Industry Research. It projects consumer spending in the Philippines will expand by 5.5% this year, but it notes elevated inflation, high borrowing costs, and an uptick in unemployment rates pose risks to the country's outlook in the near term. It also flagged risks to remittances, which is an important source of income for many Filipino households. Headline inflation slowed for a sixth straight month to 4.7% in July, but it's still above the central bank's target range of 2 to 4%. The Philippine finance chief stresses the urgent need for a reform bill for the pension system of soldiers, policemen, and other uniformed personnel. Secretary Benjamin Diokno says the core objective of these reforms is to address the unsustainability of the current pension system. Diokno explains the reforms will pave the way for a timely delivery of fair retirement benefits while lessening the strain on the government's budget. His statement comes as the House Ad Hoc Committee holds its first hearing on the MUP pension reform bill today. Diokno has said the current pension system exposes the government's budget to economic and fiscal downturns. The Philippine government urged to investigate a spike in rice prices. This, as some groups believe, a cartel might be manipulating the price of the staple grain. Jervis Manahan reports.
To investigate the recent surge in rice prices,
House Speaker Martin Romualdez and Congressman Erwin Tulfo conducted a surprise inspection of some wet markets in Metro Manila. Romualdez has this reminder to rice traders in the country.
Para hindi makaroon tayo ng artificial na shortage, huwag naman i-hoard o huwag lang itago, ilabas na lang.
But for Rice Watch Group Bantay Bigas, the lawmaker should have visited warehouses instead.
Sa palengke, na-deliver na. Ano ang imomonitor nila doon? Yung napakataas na presyo ng bigas, tapos wala din naman silang magawa. Kundi dapat buksan na yung mga warehouses ng mga importers, mga millers, para makita yung volume ng bigas na meron sila at tignan kung talaga bang angkop pa ba na mag-import given na malapit na yung ating anihan.
Bantay Bigas and other groups believe that a cartel is manipulating the price of rice in the country.
Simpleng pag-jack up nationwide ng presyo ng bigas ay resulta yan ng price manipulation. Walang nagagawa ang gobyerno dahil buffer stocking na lang sila. Mula nung natanggal yung 27 pesos at saka 32 pesos na NFA rice ay talagang kahit bahang-baha tayo ng imported na bigas ay hindi na talaga bumababa hanggang sa 25 pesos.
But the Department of Agriculture admits it would be hard for them to confirm if there was indeed price manipulation, especially now that the National Food Authority has been stripped of its regulatory powers.
Sa ngayon kasi hindi natin pa pwedeng sabihin na price control, no? Anong basihan natin? We are not in a position na sa emergency time na may price control.
The DA says it is open to checking the warehouses to see the actual rice volume in the country. In an earlier statement, DA Senior Undersecretary Domingo Panganiban said the government arranged cheaper rice imports from Vietnam. They are also talking to India to allow imports based on humanitarian reasons. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
China set to dislodge Japan as the world's top car exporter by the end of the year. Credit ratings agency Moody's Analytics said China has passed South Korea and Germany to become the second largest car exporter in the past 2 years. Now, this year, a surging demand for electric vehicles sent overall auto exports from China beyond the levels seen before the pandemic. In the first half of the year, China's EV exports receipts doubled from the same period last year. EV car sales jumped to more than 10 million in 2022, with China leading the way and accounting for about 60% of the market.